Dire team ban. Complexities turn to ban.
Ah, come on.
Dire team ban.
Yeah, it was rather tiny, but South American internet's unfortunately not the greatest.
Complexities turn the shack. Dire team pick.
Life stealer.
Dire team pick.
Rubik.
Complexities turn to pick. Ten seconds remaining.
I think try and shore up their early lanes a little bit. Maybe have Kotaro not go down early on, give him a good start. Either, you know, give him a good matchup and help him out a little bit. The Slaughter did rotate down early on. But I think their best shots in a lot of these games where one team is just like clear favorites over the other, then the best thing to do is just try and win your lanes, get an early lead so you can maybe take the game from there and catch them off guard.
Juggernaut.
Dire team ban. Ten seconds remaining. Complexities.
Yeah, I think neither ban. Both of those heroes aren't too bad.
Dire team ban.
I don't think Kunk is amazing. Hero, he's just kind of low on damage, and if you're sort of all in, where if you miss your boat, you know, you don't get a lot of levels, then you're just sort of this X, which is nice when you're ahead, but if you're behind, then this hero that, you know, almost like a disruptor, but a little bit worse, because you don't have that silence, you don't have near as much kill potential, is he's just sort of this hero that, you know, really needs to be ahead, needs to be setting up kills, needs them to be far away, and then them running, or you running at them, otherwise then he just has a hard time landing his spells and doesn't have the biggest of impacts.
Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining. Reserve time. Dire team pick. Ten seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Yeah, I think OD off and on. In the recent past, with him getting the damage nerfs and then several of those astral nerf ranges in lane, he's not near as obnoxious as he used to be. There was whenever his W started out at the max range, that was awful. So annoying to deal with. But now, with it being considerably nerfed, OD is not actually that amazing in lane. Starts at either, I think, high 50s in damage, so you can actually lane verse it with most heroes nowadays. But yeah, Viper and Razor are just the most cancer heroes ever to lane verse. Complexities turn to pick. Ten seconds
remaining.
This is
Dire
this is true.
Pick.
Wait. Max. Wait, hang on. You broke up a little bit there. What did you say?
Turn to pick.
Oh. Yeah, not too much. Freedom, one of the teams, still picking that hero up quite a bit. They'll actually just first pick it all the time. Some other teams experimenting with it here and there, going for, you know, more of a mech build sometimes, playing him like a lot of the other typical offliners. But Complexity picked him up the other day. They went for the Vlad's Abaddon, so more of the Vlad's and Max passive after the shield, so more of the old classic Logan buff style. Pushing down the lanes like a maniac until you die, trying to TP out, buy as much space as possible. So we'll see which style they go for this game. Yeah, X Mike, an Abaddon specialist. He played it once yesterday. I don't see him play it much in pubs. Spams a lot of Underlord. Plays a lot of Monkey King. That here, obviously not in Captain's mode. Hasn't played too much Abaddon in pubs, but can play it. Not the most complicated of heroes.
Shadow Fiend. Dire team ban.
Yeah, I think it's really nice against this Juggernaut. Ogre Axe can be a very strong dual lane, and it kind of forces Complexity to bring all three of their supports down to this bottom lane potentially, so it can open up space for the rest of the heroes around the map. Axe also very nice versus Juggernaut, as he just sort of beats himself to death. Doesn't care about the stun that goes through Blade Fury, so doesn't really care about the Jug spin TPing out. Overall, just a strong laner here that can go back to jungle and get the blink reliable, even if they commit three heroes down to this bottom lane. The armor really nice versus the diabolic edict as well whenever you berserkers call. So overall, just a nice pick, and like you said, you really need a vehicle for this lifestealer, or he's just sort of a walking around do nothing hero. As he's also versus the Abaddon, so it's having that stun that goes through that the shield can't purge off is absolutely key. If they did pick something like a Sand King, their Slaughter, if it wasn't banned out, this Abaddon just always behind, shielding off those stuns, and the Lifestealer never really has the time to lock onto anyone and blow them up.
Ten seconds remaining.
Earth Spirit.
Dire team pick.
Storm Spirit!
Yeah, it's a nice pairing with the Lifestealer, so it gives them multiple vehicles. Typically, whenever you do have this Lifestealer Axe, or just Lifestealer in general, and you have another vehicle, you want a hero that really likes to take up the space on the map. So Storm, a hero that really likes to push out waves, constantly be farming. It also gives you a late game vehicle for this Lifestealer, so the Axe doesn't always have, isn't super obvious every time you see this Axe and Lifestealer's missing, you know he's inside. So it gives you a few more options. Obviously, only really this Earth Spirit that's good versus the Storm. And whenever you think of, good disables for a Storm, you'll typically think of an Earth Spirit. His disables take a little bit of time to get out there. He has to roll in, unless he has, early Blink Dagger. So, Taro, also pretty infamous for his Storm. Very good Storm player in his own right. So, I think it's a good comfort pick as well. So, getting another right-clicking core to benefit from the Bloodlust.
And I actually, had witnessed NP yesterday in their matchup against DC. They had the same thing, the Lifestealer Storm Spirit, and it was ridiculous even into the later game how they were able to just insta-kill someone like Weeha's Ember just based on when they... If they get good timings with the Storm Spirit and they get the Orchid, like a jump-in Orchid bomb with the Lifestealer is just nothing to laugh at. So we'll see if it's kind of a weapon that Infamous are going to be able to pull out here. But look at this, just like we saw in the earlier series, in the first game of DC versus Doo-Wop, Misery was able to get in with his Chen and got this ward down, and it became so critical for him. And here, Complexity get it also, so this is very nice for them. Totally watching over the bottom lane. I mean, am I overplaying that ward a bit, Quinn? You can be honest with me.
The one that's they put down by the on the hill by the Dire Tier 1?
Yeah.
That ward is extremely important. It lets you see, you know, what kind of lanes they're setting up for whenever they're rotating in out of this lane. So it lets the Complexity supports know, hey, do we need to be doing this bottom lane or can we rotate to other lanes? You know, are they setting up for a kill in this SF? Should we be behind him? Just gives them info on where the heroes are running. Those deep wards like that, instead of just your typical like lane wards, give you information on where people are headed, which is much more useful than information on where people are.
And Cole will take in all that information and be able to apply it accordingly as they deal with a little bit of harassment towards the mid lane here. Cancel already going to get in the back end of the Stinger Club. Stinger in full force now, just looking to kind of keep cancel in check. This is going to hurt quite a bit, but Z-Freak is not going to assist this in the mid lane. It looks like he's going to take his attention towards the bottom lane, and they're going to try to make an early impression on this Axe. We'll have to see how easily this can happen or not. But, I mean, Swindle's here, hasn't leveled up a spell yet, but here they're going to make the go. Rolling Boulder with block and help. He has to cut all the way back. This is going to be like a full duration Blade Fury, and it will easily get the job done. Z-Freak will pick up the last hit and the first blood too.
Yeah, he's skilled Battle Hunger level 1 on this Axe as well, so he has to come back to this lane and he has TP down, so he doesn't have the luxury of going back to the jungle. He's committed to trying to pressure this tri lane as much as possible. Let him get a 2v1 mid, so get Katara off to a good start and maybe sacrifice himself a little bit, but try and catch up later with the Storm, maybe making space for him, this Ogre.
And they are going to easily zone him all the way back, so he can't even get close enough to try to go for the level 2. Brothers, being able to zone him all the way back. Up on the other side of the world here, we do have the monkeys offlane Abaddon, as he just zones back the Lifestealer, just shrugs him right off.
Katara's doing Katara things, dropping his null on the ground and last hitting without it.
Okay. Cancel, you know, what do you think? As I don't know how much you know about Cancel as a player or not. Is this something, would it phase Cancel at all as he's shrugging it off a bit? I mean, we know Katara, he's been doing this for years, that's the Katara now, but... You know, what do you think Cancel's taking it in as?
Yeah, I don't know how much Cancel's actually played against Katara, so I don't know if he's used to doing this. He's not playing the SF on Katara, so not able to do the SF taunt, the
It's not
the most annoying thing in the world.
Oh, look at this! He's gonna be able to make his move in, gets the pullback for Cancel. Not able to get the finish, so he goes for the salve. But, Katara really feeling himself here in the mid lane a bit. And I'm curious to see if Cancel is going to be able to kind of make sure he keeps his mentality in check. But Stinger's right on his corner, too. They're just pressuring the Shadow Fiend as much as possible. Z-Freak going to step away from the bottom lane now, so it looks like he's looking to help out his mid laner a little bit.
Yeah, I guess the Electric Vortex is level 3, actually, so really trying to style on Cancel.
Yeah,
really kills.
Here comes some help. Z-Freak looks to step in, but Cancel's trapped inside with the illusions as he's going to get beaten down. Z-Freak trying to go for a return kill, but that's the very fat and takey Ogre. Level 1 spell like that Boulder Smash is not going to be good enough. So good takedown there for Infamous, taking it and evening things up.
Yeah, and like we talked about earlier, Kira, you know, running down into this bottom lane, getting the Battle Hunger early on. Both the supports coming there, and they do get the first blood, but no. Cancel way behind on CS, Katara up to 17.
Okay.
Three now, but
well, now they're going to be able to get some help. I mean, this is what you would typically see from your Earth Spirit maybe at the start of the game, but he'll wait a little bit and now be able to take it to the Storm Spirit. Until that Storm gets level 6, he's going to have a hard time dodging stuff like that, so they take it right back to him, and this is going to help out Cancel quite a bit.
Yeah, was it only, you know, one or two souls, now up to 18, so going to be basically even in this last hitting battle, even with the early advantage the Storm got. Katara still trying to push up. Kind of flashy, but Stinger smoking in as well, so they really want to keep Cancel down, give Katara that early in lead and try and let him take over this game, as he can't, whenever he is ahead and not in a throwing mood, can be a very, very flashy, dominant player.
That is for sure. One we see able to utilize an advantage real nicely. If there's an opportunity to snowball and style, like, he will be there to do it. Here comes Z-Freak, though, going for his own roll. Nice snag of the bounty rune, and now they could converge onto little Hope here. Rubick will squaddle back to the lane, but we'll see if Z-Freak looks to make any sort of engagement happen. Not too much kill potential, but they're thinking about it. He's pulling him, he's drawing him back towards Z-Freak. He's gonna have to roll in. Monkeys needs help, so he'll have to dish out the shield, but a few more right-clicks should be able to get the finish. Monkeys hiding within the trees. Gonna go to the other end. Medjez, will he cut him off? Z-Freak's trying to block him back. Monkeys doesn't know where to go. He'll have to go back the other way, but Z-Freak has pulled all the attention onto him, and now they'll go back to look for Monkeys, and he gets the deny. Nice little play right there, Z-Freak. You know, doing the support thing. Helping him out. Oh, Kotaro,
good,
what
night,
happened?
Kotaro. Wow, just playing with fire. Almost gets the solo kill on cancel, but actually going for the super early raindrop on the S before boots actually saves his life. So Kotaro continuing to try and be fancy, get these solo kills, and just sort of just outskill cancel, but not really going his way there. Almost goes down, barely dodges the ray as the swindle rotates in. So very, very close mid. It's about 50 HP on Kotaro and about 100 on cancel.
There we go, level 6 is online with the help coming in from Stinger. They put cancel into a corner, quite literally, and they're going to be able to break him. He jumps up to above, finishes him off, and walks away. He'll be able to style away from this one now. And we'll have to see if this is now going to be the beginning of some untapped energy here from little Kotaro. Now that he's gotten to that level 6, he already claims kill.
Yep, dodges the... the stun, gets the kill, so nice for him, but it is out of mana and the shrine on cooldown, so SF gonna be fine coming back into this lane. We'll see if Stinger continues to rotate to this mid lane of pressure, with Melons getting a ward down to spot anybody rotating in as Rubick runs over.
Oh, swing and a miss though on that stun. He goes for the lift, pulls it right back into the arms of the storm, gets a good hit in, but now he's short on mana and he's eating an edict. Raze is there, he'll be able to turn back and get the finish. He does lose his own life, and Rubick's able to hide inside the pit. Walks right back out, and cancel will quickly realize what's going on here. Z-Freak shows up now, though. They need a stun, and it looks like they'll just kind of eyeball each other a bit, but nothing will be coming out of it. But my
yeah, Kotaro, maybe a little kill happy. Pops the Soul Ring, the Remnant turns to hit instead of zipping away, so valuing getting the kill over his own life. Cancel getting that pickup kill there. The net worth gap being closed a little bit, but still on a decent pace in the Storm Spirit. Does have the Soul Ring now, as well as the Bottle Raindrop and the Boots. So a pretty good start for the Storm.
Brings him back to the lane. I'd love to touch base here at the bottom. All that attention's been drawn away. Valentine's been able to kind of continue his path of farm right now. Picking up his Tranquils. Another deep ward will be planted by Z-Freak just around the corner. And just around that corner is a smoke movement here. Z-Freak gotta be careful, walking out. He does walk out now. To find himself on the helping end of a soon-to-be gank. As Infamous are on the move, they now spot that Moose in the lane. And they're gonna rotate over. And Moose committed now. He's going for the Blade Fury because he thinks him and Z-Freak are gonna have a gank. And they actually might be able to get the axe down. But here comes the troops. All these supports are going to be able to get redemption here, trying to go for Moo. Moo just runs within the trees, looking to hide, but he's burning up to the ignite. Runs back out the other way. There's a right click. It's going to be able to get the finish. They lift it up now. Swindle shows up. Will eat the fire blast. Z-Freak's looking to take down the Rubick. They will be able to get the kill, make it a 2-for-1 trade. Advantage for Cole. They're not done yet, looking to roll in, but it's an ogre. He's not going to be an easy grab, so all right. Chaos breaks out quite a bit, but Complexity managed to walk away with a slight upper edge.
Yeah, I think Infamous fairly okay with how the pace the game is going currently. They get the nice kill on Moo, so shutting him down a little bit. Axe still quite far away from his Blink Dagger. There's a ring of regen, so maybe not going immediately into that Blink Dagger, but Lifestealer having a very good game. Storm having a decent amount of farm, so enabling their cores, having a much better start than they did in the first game.
Oof, Moo able to sidestep the call and get the finish onto the Ogre, just running right around him. That is going to be bringing that Ogre down a peg, where the supports are looking to actually get their own way. As we see J-Hope mid lane, he's like, okay, great, soul time for me. He gets to his level 6, so now we have Spellsteel ready to work with now, but starting to feel like Cole are taking a bit advantage here of the farm available on the map. And I haven't even been able to really see. I mean, Monkeys has just been kind of hanging top lane. Like, how long before he, like, goes out and does something, and he's going to just be at quickly level 8 or 9.
Yeah, the Abaddon, extremely hard to punish. Especially once he gets, like, level 4 or level 5, the shield's just starting to absorb too much damage. And if it's Infamous, not with the most high damage supports of Rubick and Ogre. Chase down Stinger here up in this top lane, but looks like he should be okay. Monkey's actually popping ult to purge off the Ignite, so gets the slow, but only level 1.
He gets that one hit in, it slows him down a little bit, but not enough for at least Swindle to feel confident throwing out the stun there, so Ogre's going to be able to walk away from this, but Cole continuing to pressure a bit. Benjaz is walking out the other way here, won't have to cross paths with him, but it seems like Cancel's been able to kind of make up for lost time a bit and farm his way through this mid lane.
Yeah, all in the meanwhile, he does get this mid tower down up back to the top of the net worth. So I think Infamous, this is sort of one of the scarier parts in the game for them. They don't have the Blink Dagger on Axe. They are not in fighting shape right now. Just want their cores to have some time and space to farm, but these supports have so much kill potential right now with the smoke as well, so they may try and set up a kill on Benjaz.
Yeah.
Really have to be worried on Infamous to try and dodge these ganks. It's extremely crucial for their cores to get online this game.
We're not able to follow up quite yet with the movement there onto the Nakes, but now a rotation's coming in from Infamous here. You know, they're not ready to fight, but they are here just in case a fight is to break out, because Cole might look to make one happen. But I guess as I say that, Swindle's already departed to elsewhere, and they'll just be satisfied with that as it stands. Mu's going to be able to put more pressure here on the bottom tier 1, but I mean, they're just kind of satisfied here. Keeping Axe in check, he's got over a grand till he's able to kind of put in the Blink Dagger. So Cole will kind of just dictate what they want to do.
It's a little bit hard for Complexity support to gank any of these lanes. Not really much kill potential on this Lifestealer. In the Storm, just mostly playing around in the jungle. They do have this ward in the Dire Jungle Complexity, so they see where the Storm is, they know where he's jungling, but hard to get in there. Zeke freak positioned down bottom behind Mu, so trying to secure this bottom tower. His Axe not the greatest at contesting these two heroes. They are chipping it down, but don't want to give it up for free, Infamous.
Yeah, they rotate in. Good zoning stun there from Zeke freak will not allow them to pursue, but they've already gotten that tower so low. It does look like it's low enough for a deny, though, so they will be taken away from that money. Melons was considering rotating over nearby, will opt to drop the ward, was kind of within sight, no, not quite in sight of that other ward, so probably able to get away with that one. But whatever the case may be, for now Storm is out from the jungle front as he's building into his Bloodstone here. I mean, is that kind of just still the go-to build-up for your Storm as opposed to just building into an Orchid first and foremost?
Yeah, you tend to be too squishy. You really want to, you know, be taking really successful fights with it, whatever your first big item is. And if that's, you know, you're taking these successful fights, you want to be getting the Bloodstone charges off of it. You don't really have the mana regen to sustain these longer fights if you just go for the Orchid. And also, you're an Abaddon versus Juggernauts, who's going to be getting a Manta. So, not the greatest first item in the world, because it'll just get purged off in these big team fights, or you'll get Silenced off and just die almost instantly without the HP the Bloodstone offers.
Yeah. For now, though, looking to finish off the stone in hand, but I mean, the Monkeys is here now, and this guy had been kind of silently farming his way up in the top lane. Still level 9, getting close to level 10, and another game with that Helm of the Dawn being able to, he's been sporting this net creep as he did in the last game too, and just kind of able to hold the lane himself. But still, we look to the Infamous supports, you know, in a position where they can't really do a whole lot. While we have Z-Freak, a support on the other team, he's doing a whole lot. Making his move in, looking to take down the Storm himself, but they're not going to have enough lockdown to stop him from being able to jump back and away here. J-Hope rolls on in, but he dies just as fast as he shows up. The bomb comes out, but it doesn't really make big connection. But as they step back, good call, make connect, but it wasn't a good call. He's going to have to back up and away here, gets netted down, and it's a bit of a scramble for Infamous as they just go on full retreat mode. Cole now are the ones looking to make chase. Can't quite get a grab onto anyone, but Infamous put all their attention all the way up in this top lane. Mu doesn't even need to get involved. He's showing up now late to the party. Thinks that at this point they're going to have the upper hand in a fight and they can just move forward with objectives.
Yeah, this is exactly what Infamous wanted to avoid, letting Complexity up, have all their lanes shoved in, and just walk down this tower. Infamous not really getting anything off of this as well, not pressuring any of the other towers, not farming on any of their cores. So Complexity very happy with this trade, and Cancel actually going for the mech. So you can see Cole know that the Storm and Lifestealer, they can get on, split up, get online, split up the map, and start getting pickoffs, and things could get grim. So gonna look to put the pressure on now as Stinger goes down as well.
Yeah, just supports just kind of hanging nearby, just are gonna be victim here of the stampede of Complexity now coming in from the north, if you will, and not really a lot for Infamous to be able to hold at this point. Ogre's back now, but they have a mech and so much power rolling for him, it's going to feel a little underfarmed of defense from Infamous. They've already locked down their prize core. That's suddenly a life stealer out of the game for 30 seconds without a buyback. I mean, this one could be quick as well. A day of 15-minute games as the Tier 3 is already going to be dropped. Complexity hoping to round things out, and unfortunately without a blinking axe, without a way to really get in there. Their tanks are being taken apart right now as Stinger's going to be set to fall. It looks like Complexity are going to be able to walk away with a 2-point advantage after this series does conclude. I hate to speak too soon, Quinn.
Yeah, they got a little too aggressive, tried to take the fight before the axe got the blink dagger, losing a couple of kills here and there, and Complexity supports getting this mech, having the HOD and the Juggernaut coming up here with the max healing ward. It's just really, really good timing for Complexity. Infamous not quite getting the farm they needed, not able to start getting up to that point where they can split them out, find pickoffs, Storm, Lifestealer, and Axe. And Ogre and Rubick not really known for being the greatest supports on playing from behind. Ogre, a hero that really needs his cores to be snowballing to succeed in the game. Whenever your supports aren't really snowballing, they're just sort of biding their time, trying to get up to a couple of items before they can fight. It's not really where Ogre thrives, as he sort of wins you one lane, but not really great at getting you ahead. Takes the cores to do that, and you know, did win mid for the Storm, but over time, the SF just catches right back up, gets the mech. Now has the Dragonlance as well, and his usefulness is basically just run out as the Storm and Lifestealer not having the impact that you want them to whenever they have this Blood Loss buffing them up.
So what led to that kind of a thing? Was it Infamous just like missing their own timing to be able to utilize the laning advantage they made for themselves? Or just like, did they fall victim to just mistiming because of the drop they put in? Because I know the Storm was kind of ready to start, you know, playing ball, if you will, but he still needed more time. And it looked like he never even had the chance to get there. Is Cole just coming online too fast? Is that what it is?
Yeah, it's a little bit of a draft thing. I think Infamous values this Ogre maybe a little higher than most teams do. The Axe getting his Blink Dagger just a little bit too late, dying a couple too many times in this offlane, not going to jungle at any point. And so Complexity just getting their items online so early. So a couple of deaths here and there, maybe some landing choices, not really getting any kills in these rotations other than this SF, but we said it's here, they can come back very easily.
Jump in, bomb, they're trying to get the finish on for Z-Freak. The mech will help keep him alive, and he dishes out the magnetizes. Cole will spread their wings and just dish out everything they can to close this one out. As Infamous try to give it one final hurrah, it is not going to lead to success. A jump in bomb is quickly defused by Complexity here, and they take the series 2-0 and get 2 points. Just like that, man. It was a fast day of Dota. Holy my god. I think we finished 4 games in 2 hours.